In this video, how to create box style transitions in 5 easy steps. The last step may make you reconsider trying to recreate the Vox look altogether. And in my opinion, it is the most important step. Step 1, we first need to analyze the visual characteristics specific to the type of movement that Vox uses in their visuals. Vox videos set themselves apart by using a lower frame rate at 12 frames per second, which in a sea of high frame rate content makes it unique and memorable. It's super easy to achieve this look, and you can easily do this in Premiere and After Effects. So in Premiere, I have this 24 frame per second clip, and I'm going to click all and nest it. Create a nest. Now that we have this nest, I can open the nest up, open up the sequence settings, change the time base to 12 frames per second. We have this 24 frame per second clip, which I've nested in its own sequence, with frame rate settings set to 12 frames per second. That's it. Here's another visual characteristic that Vox uses. Look how I'm moving my hands. Do you see that? Do you notice something weird? It looks a bit unnatural. That's because I've changed the camera settings to reduce the amount of motion blur. That's right, Vox does not use motion blur in their graphics, text animations, visual animations, and it's more justified in this case because it's on-screen graphics, but you expect motion blur when it comes to viewing a real human on screen, and that's how Vox sets itself apart by taking out the motion blur altogether. That creates contrast, that creates this unique, memorable look. And the best part of this is that you can create your animations directly in Premiere Pro using the effects controls panel. No extra step to add motion blur. Let's talk about the movements for a second. They're always smooth, slowly eases out, and then whips into speed, and then slowly eases in. So it's got that shape to it. An easy way to do this in Premiere and After Effects is to add an adjustment layer over the shots you want to connect. Navigate to the effects panel to locate the transform effect and apply this to the adjustment layer. The transform effect on an adjustment layer, when changing its properties, directly affects the tracks beneath it. We use the transform effect because simply adjusting parameters using the properties or effects controls panel doesn't work in the same way. Start by mapping out your transition with linear keyframes. When you're adjusting, be aware of the crop on each shot. Scale is necessary. Then apply an ease out and an ease in. Vox movements are generally a bit more emphasized than the default eases. So from here, you can open up the graph editor and adjust the curve to a snappier ease. Make sure if you're animating multiple properties like position and scale that your curves are identical or you'll run into some issues. This curve type, it works so well because even with the subtle movement, you can make use of cutting at the height of the action or the curve. We're able to make use of the speed of movement as a way to create misdirection. It's at the fastest point at that point in the graph at the top of the curve. Take a look at this transition here. This is where things get a little bit weird. It's cutting on action. That's not weird at all. Yeah, you're right, but the way they cut on action is different. It's inconsistent. You have this transition where the cut is made on the action, and then we have this transition here, which is where the cut is also made on the action, but that doesn't always happen at the top of the curve. And this can draw more attention to the cut. And in other cases, technically, we're not even cutting on action at all, but we're cutting into the beginning of the movement. And this is where I find it strange, but I think it still works. We don't focus so much on the cut itself, but the movement in the frame, bringing focus to the information on the screen where the movement in the frame is or where the movement is moving toward. So we're cutting on action, cutting into action, and where the cut happens on the curve isn't always at the height of the action. When you're cutting at the height of the curve, there's not really anywhere else to go in terms of speed of movement because we're at the height of action. If you wait too long to make the cut, then you might get this awkward feeling that something isn't quite right. We've stuck around too long on the previous shot and feel the tension of that. And if you cut too early, then we might feel robbed of the moment and not enough tension is built, leaving us feeling like something is missing. Cutting at the height of the action provides that satisfaction of completeness, and it's the perfect amount of tension buildup before the cut. These are subtle movements, so the effect of cutting too early or cutting too late may not even be in play here. But am I saying you need to cut at the height of the action each and every time to create that satisfactory edit? Absolutely not. And this is where the most important aspect of video editing, in my opinion, comes into play. I often say in my online classes, story is your guide. We use story to guide every single editing decision in the story we're telling. Cutting before or after or at the height of an animation curve on a transition can sound a bit too theoretical, but it becomes a more important technique when working with pacing and rhythm in your edits. Here's a completely different example, say like a horror movie. Then cutting around the height of the action might be better. So you're lingering more on that shot than maybe the audience wants. Staying on that individual shot creates that dis-ease and tension. Why haven't we cut yet? Let me see more information. No, we as editors are not revealing that information because we're building tension. This supports this specific story. How this relates to box transitions or when creating your own transitions is to make sure that they are motivated by the story you're telling. Vox doesn't always use these smooth transitions. In fact, most of the time they don't. A lot of the times they use hard cuts rather than fancy movements because it suits the story, it's motivated. Here, it uses a mouse click sound to hard cut to more info. It's creating that feeling like we as viewers are also browsing online the same web page. These flashing hard cuts emulate a number of photos being taken with ease. This film, it's all about Kodak's new instant camera technology. And this type of transition works incredibly well to tell this specific story. And this is why you might just decide, hey, this Vox style is not gonna work for my video. Does it suit the story you're telling? Is it motivated? Or are you just doing it because you think it looks cool? If it's the latter, you can make a valid argument maybe not to use that type of style for your particular video. Think of some other visual aesthetics that you can apply that will better suit the story you're telling. One other way you can create seamless, smooth transitions is found in this video here. Take a look at that. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.